We've been on this journey through the microcosmos together for a few years now, and while that journey is soon coming to an end, we know that some of you still have questions. Questions that we wanted to take this last opportunity to explore. We'll be talking about how we make this channel, our feelings about microbes, and more. And in that more category, we're going to begin with a question that we did not expect to be asked, but that is definitely a thought-provoking one. Which microbe do you think would taste the best? For me, I think an easy answer is a pretty uncharismatic microbe that we eat all the time, which is yeast. Of course, I think mostly the thing that we liked about yeast is their byproducts, their leavings is what tastes good about yeast. But it makes me feel like a yeast, like I've got like an imagination of a yeasty flavor, but I feel like this is a bit of a cop-out. And in fact, I should be more focused on ciliates, which is what we mostly talk about here on this channel. And as far as ciliates go, I think probably like cyanobacteria maybe, because it might have that like sort of seaweedy umami flavor. But I think that James, our master of microscopes, would be more qualified to answer this one.
So the euglenids, they look like little jelly beans and they look very gooey inside. I think I would like to take a bite out of them, but also I would like to taste the stentors. I think with the stentors, I feel like they would taste a bit like seafood, and I would like to just put some lemon, maybe some herbs, you know, like some parsley, some arugula or something. I don't know. Like, I think I can make a salad out of stentors.
Our next question is something we've talked about quite often. When you are looking at a new sample, how in the world do you have any idea what it is? And how were these things understood in the first place? When it comes to the history of how people have identified these organisms, early microbiologists took a lot of notes and drew some beautiful illustrations to keep track of the species they were naming and describing. If you want a sense of how detailed those illustrations can be, you can watch our episode on the 19th century naturalist Christian Gottfried Ehrenberg.
When it comes to microscopy, there's a big learning curve. Still, there are some times like I see something under the microscope and it just blows my mind, like I cannot make sense of it. What I recommend is don't focus on identification, but just focus on just learning about the things that you may see under the microscope sometime. I always encourage people to send me an Instagram message, send me a video with that question, and I'm gonna get back to you right away.
If you want to know more about how to build some of that experience, we actually have an episode about how to identify microbes. And of course, experience also means mistakes, and that's what our next question is about. Have you ever misidentified an organism on the show? To talk about that a little bit, let's turn to our writer, Deboki.
We have definitely gotten things wrong, particularly when we're looking at organisms that are outside our area of expertise. So we try as much as possible to find other experts to help us with those identifications. But there's one mistake in particular that's not really a misidentification where we got the organism wrong, but we did talk about it in a way that continues to haunt us. In one of our early episodes, we called tardigrades six-legged. Yeah, we just accidentally chopped off two legs in our description. And ever since then, we've learned to be very careful about how many legs we mention. We also got asked about how the process of writing an episode works. While each episode is its own journey, they start in the same place. James finds something cool and tells us about it. From there, he gathers footage and writes an outline with some of the ideas he has for the episode, along with research I might be able to use as a starting point. I usually go on and do some more research to see what else I can learn. This is the trickiest step because many of the microbes we're talking about are rare or not very well studied. So I might have just a handful of papers to turn to. But it can also lead to some really delightful rabbit holes, especially when I get to read old papers that have a lot more personality to them than modern scientific writing. When it comes to writing, the two questions I ask myself at the start of any episode are, what does this microbe make me feel, and what do we want to highlight in James's videos? Those questions are ultimately about the science and the story the microbes are telling us, even if they don't know they're doing that. And I do all of this with a lot of help. First from James, and then from our producers and editors who help shape these ideas, and then from Hank, who brings them all to life. And while he may not be involved on the writing side, our editor, Chayton Whaley, is the person who makes sure that everything, that means the writing, the narration, the music, and the videos, all come together. And he's going to answer our next question, which is how he knows what level of magnification or scale a given clip is.
When James sends over the footage for whatever given episode we're working on, he names every clip with whatever micro we might be looking at and the magnification level. Then we have a nice little cheat sheet for the micron conversion, but over time, I've just sort of memorized that. Now, sometimes things do slip through the cracks, and a file isn't labeled or isn't labeled correctly. And over time, you just sort of learn to spot when something feels wrong. Especially when it's a species you've edited footage of several times prior, like a tardigrade or stentor. But no, I definitely can't spot it by eye. But I've at least gained the ability to tell when something might be wrong.
Now that we've talked a little bit about how this channel is made, let's talk a little bit about the feelings microbes have inspired in us, starting with what made James discover and start falling in love with microbes.
For me, like all my life, I was very fascinated by different topics. I take one topic and then I finish it quickly and then I move on to another one. But with microscopy, at that moment when I saw the microbes under the microscope, I knew that this is not a topic that I can finish quickly, I can move on quickly. It's just the more I learn, the more I felt like I know nothing. Seeing something new with your own eyes, it's a very interesting thing. It just imagine you're taking a walk outside and seeing a new species of, I don't know, lion. So that's what you do with microscopy. You see new things, things that, you know, nobody has ever seen before. This is an amazing feeling, and it's so captivating to me, and it's addictive. And yeah, what is love? You know, just obsession after all.
And next, we have a question that we've been asked in different Q&As, but that we've wanted to answer again, because like microbes, we're always changing. So, what is our favorite and least favorite microorganism to look at? For me, even though they move slowly and do not change shape, and that's very fun, like when the Lacrimaria will just like reach out and stab somebody, I think instead I have to go with diatoms. I know they're kind of boring, they're a microbe where I can sort of really feel the intersection between biology and geology just by looking at them. Like, biology and geology, much more intertwined than we think, but with diatoms, it's sort of like right there on the face of it. And they come in so many different shapes and sizes. They're like little living snowflakes, and they feel also very alien to me. They're almost like what life from Mars might look like.
So I really liked stentors at the beginning. I think they were my favorite. Then it became Lacrimaria. But I think in the end, my favorite microbe is legendary Aloesia. Just a handful of people saw this organism under the microscope. And, you know, after some thousands of hours of searching for it, like I was able to find just a handful of them. If I see another one, I would feel very, very lucky. My least favorite microbe is worms. When I see them wiggle, when I see them do this, like their little wormy dances, I don't know, it gives me goosebumps.
For a long time, my favorite microbes to look at were amoebas, because it's so fun to see what shapes they'll shift into. But part of writing about organisms is finding different ways to fall in love with them. And writing the episode about sea anemones was particularly personal and special to me. As for least favorite to look at, probably mites. Especially because writing about them means acknowledging that they are everywhere.
A lot of you have asked how you can continue to support James's microscopy and the team. First off, thank you to everyone who has supported this channel, whether by watching or sharing or contributing to Patreon or buying one of our microscopes or our merchandise stuff. We've loved working on this show, and we have loved having an audience who loves it too. We have two more episodes left, and we are very excited for you to see them. There's experimentation, there's history, and of course, there's the microcosmos. And after that, The channel will continue to be on YouTube, so you will be able to revisit all your old favorite organisms, and who knows, maybe at some point there will be more uploads in the future. Plus, you can always see more of James's adventures on his Instagram, Jam and Germs. To support James directly, we will put a link to James's Linktree where you can see his scientific publications, his Patreon, a donate button, and also you can order his book, which I think would be an amazing way to support James, and also you get a very cool book. Journey to the Microcosmos is a production of Complexly, and the team behind this channel will continue to be working on other Complexly projects. So one way you can support the team is to check out more of our shows like Bizarre Beasts or Eons or SciShow, so you'll always be able to see our work in various places on the internet. We also have a Complexly YouTube channel that you can follow for more news on our productions. I'm probably going to use that for something someday, and we'd love to have subscribers there, so you can go follow us there. It means a lot to us to hear this question, that y'all are still thinking about how you would like to support us, even after this channel stops regularly uploading. And to end our Q&A, we were asked, when was the moment you knew that you were doing something special with this channel? And for me, and maybe this is a little embarrassing, but it's when I was reading through a script, and it was early in the channel, and I realized that just 2 weeks before, I didn't even know what a ciliate was. Like, I had heard of a bunch of ciliates, but I did not know about, like, how they were classified and that there was this group of organisms that was a tremendously diverse group of organisms that was all around us. Like, my personal understanding of the microcosmos was tremendously limited. I didn't even have the language to think about that world. And when I discovered that there was something, this, like, new thing in my life that would keep me endlessly fascinated, I knew that it must also be possible for that to be the case for hundreds of thousands of others. So, thank you all once again for making these moments possible. It is wonderful to have been able to do something that feels so special to us. But perhaps the greatest lesson from the microcosmos is that it is even more of a gift to be able to share those special things with others. So thank you for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us.